What was everybody's reaction to that when he finally came to and they ministered to him and everything? Steve, are you okay? Or Steve, are you okay? And everybody was, my gosh, you know, we're feeling for him. It's hard to make up. But anyway, whatever the fear is, I'm afraid such and such is going to happen. At the end of what we're talking about today, or at least at the end of the whole spiel, you see that a lot of these fears are not really rational fears. But anyway, that's the way that procedure usually goes. There are three, well, let's put it another way. There are three main therapies, all the therapies out there, and each of the three that I consider the main ones targets a different part of that process. Very, very briefly, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on the ones that I don't follow that closely. But there's one called systematic desensitization. I don't know if the person who talked to you last week talked about it or not, but basically this targets the physiological reaction. And it might work for some of you better than anything else. So let me describe it briefly, and you can sort of say to yourself whether it sounds like a bunch of ooey or whether it sounds like something that might work. But it starts off, you don't have to have a therapist for this, there are tapes. But it starts off, let's learn how to relax. And sort of a little bit like yoga, a little bit like transcendental meditation and other kinds of meditation, let's learn how to totally relax all the muscles and then feel when you come out of that relaxation. So that's step number one, you learn that. Then you imagine certain situations. And if you can imagine the situation, they're graduated from very low threat all the way up to the last step is you imagine yourself going in front of the audience and starting your speech. But in between, you start off with something very low threat, like imagine yourself in the audience of somebody else's speech or something like that. And if you feel yourself coming out of that relaxation state, well then, hold it, let's go back and work on that until you can imagine that relaxed. Then the next one, if you don't feel relaxed with the next one, then go back and keep working until you can go all the way up to the top. If anybody's interested in that, I can put you or Margaret onto a list of those graduated steps for stage fright. They've got them for snakes and they've got them for everything imaginable, but I've got the list for stage fright and it's been gift to you. There's another approach that concentrates on the interpretation phase. Basically says you're interpreting your stage fright anxiety, your public speaking anxiety, in a way that doesn't make sense. Tell me what you're afraid of. And then this does have to be done with the therapist. Well, let's examine that fear. Is that really a legitimate fear? You're afraid of making a fool out of yourself. Is that very likely to happen, provided that you respect the audience and worked on your speech? One of my favorites is students will tell me, I'm afraid of getting a bad grade. And I'll say, make you a deal. I won't grade you. Go ahead and give me a speech. No anxiety, right? No, it's still there. Well, then you weren't afraid of the grade, were you? It was something else. But there's an approach called rational emotive therapy that just takes you through all of those fears one at a time for several minutes apiece. And then there's a third one, the one I'm going to talk about most, that concentrates on that initial step in the anxiety chain of assessing the situation. And basically this approach claims that almost everybody, and the research supports this so far, almost everybody who has high anxiety about giving speech has a different assessment of the situation, a different orientation, I'm going to call it, toward public speaking, than those who have low anxiety. And there are two basic orientations, and one is anxiety-producing, and the other one is non-anxiety-producing. As I go through this, I think I'm going to have an easy time convincing you that the favored orientation is less anxiety producing. That makes pretty good sense. What I have trouble with when I used to do this in private therapy is convincing the person that approach is going to make for better speeches. because most of us have been convinced another way. But I guarantee you, not only does the favorite approach make for less anxiety, it does make for better teachers too. But let's talk about those two assessments. One is one that I call a performance orientation. And this is the, now, y'all haven't all bought and read the book, have you? Okay. I'd love it if you bought and read it and everybody said, we're here, you don't need this class anymore, so we don't need you either, but if it's down here with you here. So as long as I'm here, I'm glad you haven't read it. Because I don't need to say repeat. So there's an orientation that I call a performance orientation, and virtually, in my experience, virtually everybody who has higher than normal anxiety about speech, like I said a little while ago, you think it's higher than normal, and probably is, but it might not be. But the people with higher than normal anxiety have performance orientation, as I call it, which means the following. When you give a speech, and I'm going to claim in a minute that this is wrong, and you haven't seen that coming, but when you give a speech, the objective is to impress people. The objective is to impress people with how good a speaker you are. And the way you do that is that there are certain special behaviors that go along with the speech, and you give a good speech by following the rules for those behaviors, whatever those rules are for eye contact and gestures and vocal variety and so forth and so on. So what's going to happen when I get up to give my speech is the audience is out there judging me as critics on whether I'm going to pull off a good performance. And it's sort of, I mean, it's a perfect analogy, I think, to Olympic figure skating or Olympic gymnastics or something like that. The judges are out there, they're watching my every move, and if I say, twice, I go from a 9.8 to a 9.6 or whatever it is. And at the end of the speech, everybody's going to hold up their little mental scorecard, and I'm going to get ratings. If you think about that for a minute, that's bound to produce anxiety. I mean, situations where we're under the microscope, and the pressure's on to perform well, whether it's the GRE or whatever it may be, produces some anxiety. When we feel like we're being scrutinized and everybody's watching us, the spotlight is on us, that produces some anxiety. And when we think there are rules, and there are rules that we're not familiar with, that makes us uncomfortable too. I don't know if you've ever had the experience of going to I've had this experience going as a guest to the Catholic Church, and I've had this experience going to Jewish Bar Mitzvah, and I imagine there are lots of other examples too. But when everybody there knows these little rules of when you're supposed to sit and when you're supposed to stand and when you're supposed to repeat after the person in the front and when you're not supposed to, and you don't know those rules, you feel a little out of place. You feel a little nervous. I hope everybody doesn't notice that I'm standing at the wrong time or whatever it might be. So that performance orientation is one that puts a big burden on us. We think we've got to be perfect. And if we think we've got to be perfect, and perform with no flaws, then we're putting a lot of pressure on ourselves. The other orientation, the preferred one, in my opinion, is what I'm going to call a communication orientation. And this one, the idea of a speech is to achieve one's communicative purpose. Now, I want to digress for a minute and talk about objectives in everyday, ordinary communication. But for public speaking, we have one of three purposes usually. We're either going to try to inform, which is your main communicative objective when you're giving a talk at a conference on your research or something like that. Sometimes we're trying to persuade, I don't think most of us would say that we're trying to give a persuasive speech to persuade the audience to accept our data results and our analysis. That's usually what they're trying to inform them what I did, and they're going to, we all know that I did it right, so I'm not trying to persuade anybody. If you decide that I'm going to go down to my PTA, my you know, my son or daughter's school and give them a piece of my mind on something I think they're doing wrong, or I'm going to go to the city council and tell them what I think of the plan to block the entrance to my road or whatever it might be. You know, you've got a persuasive speech. And then the third type is entertaining speeches, which most of us don't do unless we're professional entertainers. But every now and then, if you're the best man at a wedding or the maid of honor or whoever it is about to give you've got to give a funny toast or something like that. Well, okay, then we've got a little short entertaining speeches, not speech to give, but those are the objectives. So the point of view is that it's a good speech if it achieves its purpose, period. So if you inform them of what it is that you were trying to inform them of, it's a good speech. If you persuade them of whatever you're trying to persuade them of, it's a good speech, period. Same thing for entertainment. But I'm not talking about that as much. Let's just back up for a minute and notice what happens in ordinary communication. In ordinary communication, there are two kinds of objectives. And I mean everyday, normal conversation. We've got what we call pragmatic objectives, which is what I'm calling, in this context, communication objectives, but either one. We've got pragmatic objectives. We're trying to find out what time it is when we ask somebody, what time is it? We're trying to get someone to find their way to West Sacramento correctly if they stopped us and asked us for directions to West Sacramento. We're trying to explain to people what we did over the break if they've asked us what you do over the break or whatever it may be. We've got these pragmatic objectives, trying to get the information to us. And we have some social objectives. We're trying to come across as a friendly person. We're trying to come across as likable. We're trying to let the person who we're talking to about our vacation break know that we care enough about them to spend the time talking with them, et cetera, et cetera. All these little objectives that are hard to put into words sometimes. With the speech, the pragmatic objectives I've already talked about, to inform or to persuade or to entertain, and by the way, yes, whichever one of those is your main objective, it involves a little bit of the others too. That's a whole other topic. You've got to give new information if you're going to persuade. You've got to persuade that you're credible, if you're informing, and all that sort of stuff. But in a speech, the social objectives are you want to come across as a sincere, likable person. You want to come across as credible. Those of you who have high anxiety, probably everybody, won't believe that sometimes your purpose is to be invited back to give another speech, but sometimes your purpose is to be invited back to give another speech. But you have these social purposes. When the social purpose gets taken too far, I want to impress them as a speaker. I want them to think I'm a hotshot. I want to wow them with my oratory. Then it's social objectives that don't belong in a speech even any more than they do belong in conversation. I want to impress this person with what a wonderful person I am, and we have no friends, and everybody thinks we're being you know what, and it doesn't work when you try too hard that way. Same thing with this. So I like to emphasize and repeat the objective is to achieve your communication purpose, period. And I've got several little hypothetical and real examples of this to sort of drive the point home, because I don't think it'd be precise enough. The first is to imagine yourself hypothetically in a speech, maybe one in here, maybe, I think at a conference is even better example. You go report your research, and a few days after the conference is over, maybe somebody's flying home on the plane after the conference, somebody who's in your audience and they're talking to somebody else on the plane, I heard a research report the other day that says that such and such, and their method was such and such, and that seems pretty good to me, and the conclusions, and this is what, and I think that's fascinating. What do you think? Don't remember who it was. Don't remember anything about the speaker. I don't remember male, female, university of what. But it sure was interesting information. That's scenario one. Scenario two, somebody from the audience, somebody else from the audience is sitting down next to someone on the plane. They say, oh, that's an interesting convention, a lot of interesting talks. There was one, this person, really impressive guy or gal, good looking, nice voice, seemed really smart, whatever you think are high compliments. Can't remember what they said, but sure didn't like looking at them or listening to them or whatever it may be. Now, I hope you know, I can tell from your reaction, that from a communication point of view, that first reaction is a good one, even if you wish they could remember you. And the second one is not a good one. Real life example. This happened to be shortly after I started a advanced public speaking course in college by a guy who I've dedicated the booklet to, who basically taught me this approach to conversationality, the connection between that and stage fright were two things, but basically this communication orientation. What was my point? So I went to, attended a high school graduation. The valedictorian got up to give the speech. All-American boy type guy, who probably was a contest debater or orator or something like that, but very flowery language, very planned gestures, very nice vocal variety and all that sort of stuff. And after the ceremony, graduation ceremony, some of the mothers were oohing and aahing about the speech. And I asked one of them, well, what do you think about what he said? I swear, I remember this very well. The answer was, I didn't really understand what he said, but it sure was a good speech, wasn't it? Now, you know, from a performance orientation, it was a good speech of everybody saying, oh, wow, I don't remember the guy's name, but didn't Joe, wasn't he impressive? He could run for senator or whatever. From a performance orientation, if that's what they're saying, then that's a good speech. But from a communication orientation, if other people too didn't know what he's talking about, that's good. And I'll just give one last example. One of my all-time favorite speeches was one by I taught at Cal State LA for a while, and a short, unpleasant while that I did for a while. But had a teaching public speaking class, had a student who was brand new to the country. I don't remember what country she was from, but Asian, I don't remember exactly where, but her parents ran a restaurant, some sort of Asian food restaurant, I don't remember the details. But apparently, when we Caucasian people would go into the restaurant and try to use chopsticks, they would laugh at us. This was 1970-something. So she brought 20 pairs of chopsticks and passed them out and taught us how to use chopsticks. Now, she could hardly speak English. From a technical point of view, you know, was she a good speaker? From a technical point of view, you know, she'd lose points on a lot of things on a checklist. But did she achieve her purpose? I know how to use chopsticks thanks to her, and I'll bet you the other 20 people in the class do too. And she achieved the purpose. Good speech. So let's see. Let me find myself here. Want to sort of go through. Oh, wow, I knew that would happen. It always does. Go through some components of this communication orientation as it's used for anxiety. And like I said, I'm not going to be able to give you the whole package, but let me just show you what some of the parts of the package are. The first thing we do is to notice the similarity between public speaking and ordinary conversation. And at first glance, people react negatively to that. Hold it. they're night and day different, giving a speech and talking in conversation, and don't tell me they're the same, they're not. Well, they are, except for three things. I bet you can't think of anything other than these three. And as I go through them, the point is, from a performance orientation, these are all three bad. From a communication orientation, all three are good. So here are the three things. One is, you get longer to prepare what you're going to say than an ordinary conversation. So from a performance orientation, you can say, well, gee, that now that means, you know, I have higher expectations of perfection or something because I had more time to memorize it or prepare it or write it out or whatever. From which, by the way, I'm going to advise that you don't do. Don't memorize or read. But anyway, from a communication orientation, having more time to prepare means I've got to think before I speak more than ordinarily. And everybody knows it's wise to think before you speak. In conversation, we sometimes don't have much time to plan what we're going to say, and we say things that we didn't need to say sometimes. More time to prepare? Great. What's wrong with that? Number two is we talk longer before the other person talks. So in conversation, we're interrupted all the time, and we say a little bit, and then they say a little bit, and we've got to follow their train of thought and all that. Most of us sort of like the idea, and I don't think there's any ego or vanity that goes with this. Most of us who have something we want to say to somebody, whether it's a spouse or a roommate or whoever it might be, we sort of like the idea of being able to say it without getting interrupted. You know, can we just say our piece and not be interrupted? So from a performance orientation, the idea of not being interrupted means, oh, all that time they're scrutinizing me and they're observing whether I'm making mistakes and they're watching. From a communication orientation, I get to talk longer without getting interrupted. And then the third one, of course, is the biggie for most people who have anxiety, and that is you get to say it to more people at one time. And from a performance orientation, and I think most of you can identify with this, even if you couldn't with the other two, I've got all those eyes on me. You know, that's too many eyes. I don't want to be under that many people's microscopes at the same time. I don't like that. From a communication point of view, It's, and think again of, you know, I think a conference is a perfect example of this, even though you might be nervous in front of your future employers and stuff like that. But you've got this information that you want to share. You've done this piece of research that you believe in. And instead of having, you know, I don't know how many people in the audience at your conferences, but I'm going to say 50, 50 different conversations to tell those 50 people about your research, you get to knock off 50 birds with one stone, so to speak, and it's just much more efficient. And if you got something important to say, why not have a lot of people hear it? And I don't think that's egotistical, it's just efficient communication. So those are about the only differences there are between conversation and public speaking. And all three of them work to this public speaker's advantage, if what you care about is communicating. They work to your disadvantage if what you care about is being looking good under the microscope. Got a point on that in a second too, by the way. The number two thing that we emphasize, and I hope I have a chance to do a little bit of this today, is to talk about the different aspects of delivery and emphasize the point to be natural on everything. Everything except possibly eye contact is about the only thing that in a speech you need to do a little bit differently than a conversation. The gestures, facial expression, making up the words on the spot, encoding spontaneously, rate, how fast to talk, all of those things, what you need to do with delivery when you get up here is exactly the same thing that you do in conversation, and I do mean pretty much exactly. Like I said, maybe one or two little exceptions. I don't know if in this class you had the first day introductory speech, or have you had a little thing where everybody gets up and gives their introduce themselves if you will.
Well, we decided to do it. We decided to wait with it, actually. So we have our first two speakers talk about anxiety and then kind of approach it after.
Well,
a little more about it.
Good, but in a way that's too bad. Because one of the beauties, I mean, it'll work fine the way y'all are doing this, it's going to work fine. But you might, when you do it, plan some things to throw the speaker off a little bit. Because, you know, the beauty of doing it the first night when people aren't expecting it. Now, I will admit, by the way, in my class that I'm doing this quarter, where everybody has self-identified as high anxiety, I didn't do it either. Okay? I talked about it, and I talked about the fact that I do it in my normal Calm 1 classes, and asked, does just the thought of that make anybody in here anxious and everybody raises their hand? But when I do that in the normal class, there are a couple of points. Number one is, how many, and I say this in your own mind, answer this question, how many people who you saw in front of you today seemed like they had anxiety? Anybody think of more than five? Never, out of 20 people. More than three? Usually. More than two? Okay, now if your hands go up. One, two. And people raise their hands saying, well, I saw one or two people who I thought anxiety. Next question, how many of you, when you were up here, had high anxiety? And everybody raises their hand. And the point there is they can't tell when you've got it. And that's real important for some people. Some people get up here and you can hear your voice quivering. They can't hear it. What actually happens, by the way, I've got so many tangents I'm going out of here, I'm sorry. But what happens is you feel your voice quivering and you think that they hear your voice quivering, they don't hear it. And they don't see your hands shaking unless you give them a reason to see it. If you're holding anything like that instead of having no cards on the podium. But anyway, point number one, you couldn't see theirs, they presumably can't see yours. But point number two, the real point I'm on right now, is okay. If you're wondering whether you know how to give a speech delivery-wise, everybody proved that you know how to do it because you didn't have any choice. You didn't have time to go home and read it. Write it out and then get up here and read it. You didn't have time to go home and write it out and memorize it. You had no choice except to do what you do in everyday conversations, which is to come up with that stuff on the spot. That's the way you deliver a speech. Now, most people with high anxiety, because of the performance orientation, think that the hard part of the speech is the delivery. The hard part is the content. The hard part is all the work that you have to do before you get up here. I've got all this information. The research took a year. I've got 10 minutes to tell everybody about it. I've got to throw out some stuff. Heck, my background literature review in my dissertation chapter one was 800 pages but I've only got five, that sort of stuff. But you've got all that planning, and here this is a little bit complicated, I've got to make sure people understand this. All that happens before you get up here, and then once you get up here you just talk. So point number two is be natural with the gestures, be natural with the facial expression, be natural with the words that come out of your mouth. Know what you're going to say, have notes, know what you're going to say, but don't know the words that you're going to use to say it. Let that happen when you get up here, just like conversation. The words will come. I'm just going to pick a number fairly accurately, though probably. I'm thinking of about 15 different ways, reason within the language, in our language, probably any language, ways to say the same thing and make the same point. And you don't have to know which one of those you're going to use when you get up here to say, now I'm finished talking about my line of work, it would be my research subjects, now I want to talk about the independent variable or whatever. A jillion ways to say that. I'm finished with that point, I'm going to this point. You don't have to plan it out word for word. So,
New Hampshire. And then the nice thing about that stage right wise is bullet points number points one and two are just saying you already know how to do it. You already know how to deliver the speech. You don't know how to do the content, but that's not the part you're worried about with your anxiety. You're worried about the delivery. You already know how to do it. The third thing, not necessarily in this order, I'd like to talk about the origins of the fear. I'd like for people to try to explore that. What was the first time you got anxiety, and where did it come from, and how come we have this notion that when you give a speech, you're supposed to have all these little perfect behaviors? I know where I think it comes from for me and people of my generation. I think it comes from, and I don't know if how many of you can, some of you will identify with this probably in some home, but I remember very well those book reports in grade school and memorizing the Gettysburg Address or Caesar's speech or whatever, preamble to the Constitution or whatever it is, and get up and giving that to the class. And two aspects of that, I think, are anxiety inducing. One is that it's a performance orientation situation. The only reason to recite the Gettysburg Address in front of a class is to give a performance. And the teacher is sitting there listening to see if you forgot a word or something like that. The class doesn't care about the Gettysburg Address. Communicate the content of the Gettysburg Address to a bunch of people in the fifth grade. It's clearly a performance. And, you know, we saw the preamble of the Constitution, and I think book reports too. We know darn well on some level we've never gone out and, or almost never, gone to the library and checked out a book because of one of our classmates' book reports. We don't care a hoot about the book they read. They don't care about the book we read. We're going through these motions. Now, there's an exception, I think, and I think show and tell is an exception. They didn't do show and tell when I was in school, but they did. They're doing it these days. Show and tell, you can actually get into communication mode. I want to tell everybody about my, you know, arrowhead I found on my vacation or whatever the heck it is. But those book reports and those memorized things are not even communication opportunities, point number one. Point number two, it is exacerbated when we're all finished with the book reports or whatever it might be, and then the teacher says, well, that was real good, everybody, but I've got a couple of comments. You know, Johnny, you shouldn't put your hands in your pocket when you talk. And Jimmy, you shouldn't grab both sides of the podium like you did. And Billy, you shouldn't be clicking your pen when you're giving a talk. And that says to our minds, there are these right and wrong behaviors. There are these right things, correct things that you're supposed to do with your hands, for example, and wrong things to do with your hands. So we get up here to give a speech, and I bet you most everybody in here has experienced this. Something makes you think about your hands, and your mind says, oh, what am I supposed to do with them? I'm not supposed to put them in my pocket. I'm not supposed to put them behind me. I'm not supposed to. They told me all the things I'm not supposed to do with them, but they didn't tell me what I'm supposed to do with them. You know, and that, you know, exacerbates the problem. So wherever it came from, you know, I think it's worth thinking about. And those who can identify with the origins for me, or at least what I think it is, well then fine, we start noticing that those are not realistic situations. Giving a book report in fourth grade is nothing like talking to your colleagues at a convention or going to the city council or anything like that, nothing at all. The fourth thing I'd like to talk about in the whole therapy approach is to ask people, and I've hinted at this a little bit, to analyze your own behaviors as an audience member and ask yourself, do you, as a normal person, sit there in the audience for other people's speeches and do to them what it is that you think they're doing to you. And the answer usually is going to be no. You sit there and say, oh, let me wait till they make a mistake. I'm dog, you know, I can give them a demerit. We don't do that. Now, in the fourth grade, yeah, I remember very well. Some of you too. You know, the guy sitting next to us gets up and gives his talk, and he sits down. Here's the number of times he said up, you know, he said 25 times or something like that. Okay, we do that in the fourth grade. That's probably because the teacher said, you know, Mary, you said oh a lot of times, and then we start getting psyched out about that too. But in an ordinary speech, we're saying, and you know this is your colleague's orientation as audience members at a conference, but the same thing with the city council or the Kiwanis Club that asks you to come talk about geology or whatever it is. They're sitting out there, the audience members are sitting out there saying, hey, let's tell me what you got. This sounds like it could be interesting, let's see if it is. And then you give them the information. And they say, wow, I can use that, I can't wait to go home and talk about it around the dinner table. Or they say, oh well, you know, interested some people, not particularly me, but that's not, you know, the end of the world. But think about how you behave as an audience member and assume that that's the way they're behaving too. And they're not saying, you're not saying, I can't wait for them to make a mistake. You're not saying, I'm going to count the mistakes. You're not saying they're starting off with a 10 and by golly, I dare them to keep a 10, I bet they're going to lose points and be down to at least a 9.2 by the time. You're not doing any of that with them. They're not doing it with you either. Like I mentioned, the guy who fainted, the audience reaction was, it's almost like people ought to do that on purpose. you want to get an audience behind you, you know, on your side, you know, have a little trouble up there. I'm sorry, there's one last thing. There's a section in the booklet, if you get it, that talks about these fears in detail, and I don't have time to go through them right now, but I've heard most of the answers to, okay, what is it that you think you're afraid of? And there's a section where I've taken those one at a time and just said from a communication orientation, if you're trying to communicate, there's no reason to be afraid of those. I'll give you one too. I'm afraid because public speaking is an unfamiliar situation, and when you get the whole spiel and start to believe that, well, no, it's pretty much like an ordinary situation, conversation, then you can't say that it's unfamiliar. I'm afraid the audience will ridicule me if I make a mistake. Talked about that a minute ago. That's not what audiences do. Professional speakers, by the way, people who get lots of money to give speeches, the same speech over and over and over, to the point where they can do it in the sleep. And I'm not saying all professional speakers do this, but some do, many do. Plan fake mistakes in their speech. They insert fake mistakes. Why would anybody do that? Well, because they want the audience to think they're human. And humans make mistakes. And the audience will not only let you get away with mistakes, but they kind of are saying, you know, and most of us are going to have no trouble with this. We don't want this person to be perfect. We want them to be a normal human being, and we make little mistakes, like made 80 probably today, little said the wrong thing, go back and change your mind and stuff like that. You do it in conversation, make sure you make the right turn it up. I mean, right is different than left, not right. And, you know, we correct ourselves and try to do things to make little clarifications. So, if your anxiety persists very long, I would, you know, get that book or borrow one from somebody and go through those little list of fears, and I think you'll see that none of the fears make a whole lot of sense.
And then I don't have time to talk about delivery very much, but I know that I should need some time for questions too. But just very, very quickly, on everything except eye contact, be natural. Gestures, I like to tell a story. My dad was in the Army. I lived 3 years in one place, 3 years in another, and the point of that is we always had new guys coming through. And a little game that we used to play on the new guys, a little trick, is new guy would be in the conversation, and one of us would remember our little trick and start staring at his hands. And then somebody else would, oh, yeah, the hand thing. And others would start staring at his hands. As soon as the guy realizes that people are staring at his hands, what, you guys? Nothing. And let him go. If you want to irritate your roommates, try that. They're angry. But they'll end up just stop, okay, forget it. They'll stop talking altogether, or they'll sit on their hands or something like that. And it's the same thing when you're up here. Let them be. They're supposed to be on automatic pilot. As soon as you start thinking about what to do with them, they automatically, it's like they say, if you think about walking, you'll trip, that sort of thing. It's the same principle. You're not supposed to think about them. Unfortunately, some of us have had some teachers make us think about them. But gestures do the same thing as facial expression, and do the same thing as vocal inflection. When somebody's talking conversationally, they are doing little things with their voice that punctuate, and their eyebrows and forehead are doing little things that go with those little oomps, and the hands are usually doing things that are going with those little oomps too. If it happened that you had memorized the speech or you're reading the speech and you don't have the gestures, then you got problems because you've got that monotone and you're leaving out all the vocal oomps and stuff, and the facial too. But if you're talking conversationally, you've got the voice doing it right, you've got the face doing the gestures, you can leave out the hands if you want to, nobody's gonna mind that. Can't emphasize enough, I may not have time to talk about eye contact, but that's okay. Basic thing on eye contact is be looking at somebody almost all the time, but look at one person as long as you want to, and then go to somebody else as long as you want to, and go to somebody else. You don't have to be looking at a person every single moment. In ordinary conversation, we look away from the person we're talking to when we're the one doing the talking. We look away 60% of the time. When you're up here, you can look away from a given individual, Rob, 100% of the time, I don't think I've seen you yet, but you're looking at people almost all the time. So that's a quickie version, or super quickie version of eye contact. But the main thing on delivery is to try to have, this comes naturally, but for the audience to feel like you have what we call directness. And that is the feeling that you're talking with them as people as opposed to orating at them. And we've all had the experience of being a member of an audience where it just feels like the speaker couldn't care less whether we're there. They're doing something up there. They're entertaining themselves, perhaps, or they're on some sort of kick. But they're sure not trying to talk to us, it doesn't seem like. And then we've been in those other audiences, and sometimes you can have 500 people in the audience, and even though the lights are dim and the speaker can't even see us, we're back there in row 20. It just feels like he or she is talking with us. It feels like they're talking to us now the same in their speech, the same way they would if they were in our living room talking to us about the same topic. That's what you want. You want to have that directness. And when we say, that person speak, they sort of sounded funny. What that means is they sounded like it was memorized, or it sounded like it was read, or it sounded like some combination of the two, as opposed to spontaneous. And the reason that it sounds funny when people are not talking spontaneously is that all that vocal punctuation is missing, and not only does it sound funny, but we're losing information. On a printed page, we've got
periods, and we've got commas, and we've got semicolons, and we've got indented paragraphs, and we've got headings, and we've got bullets, and all these things that, that help the reader track where the writer's mind is. We have that in conversation, too. All those little pauses and all those little pause for a second, pause for a millisecond, all of those things are the punctuation. For some reason, well, another reason, but anyway, when people memorize or read, it's funny, you read from a manuscript, the commas and the periods are there, but it doesn't come out in your voice. And the audience has trouble tracking the person who doesn't have that normal punctuation. It's valuable information that's missing. So very important that you put it in your own words. And I'll just say, last story, I remember very well my wife having a speaking engagement that she had to do where her company wanted her to give a speech that they had written out. She was very frustrated with this and tried and never had been that crazy about giving speeches anyway. And I kept telling her, put it in your own words, put it in your own words, put it in your own words. And she would try, and after a couple of days, I can't do it. And after a few weeks of this, let me have a speech. And I'm not bragging here, but I'm saying this is the way to do the speech, I think. I took it. It was all written out, about 20 pages. I took some notes. I had it for about 20 minutes. Came back in about 20 minutes and said, let me give you the speech. And used the notes. And the notes served the function of reminding, this is what notes are for, of reminding me what the points were going to be and reminding me of the order in which I was going to make the points, but not what words I was going to use. Notes were very, very sketchy. What she did, she was a little bit ticked because I made it look so easy and she'd been working so hard on it, and she was a little bit amazed. But what she had been doing, it turned out, is I would say put it in your own words, and she would put it in her own words, and then try to memorize that. And that's not what I mean. I mean put it in your own words on the spot. So hopefully some of those things will help, and with the anxiety and the speech. The class goes till 2, not 3, right? Okay, so I better stop because I think probably a little over time.
Thank you.
Margaret, you told me 35, machine jam. I would suggest that y'all please pass these around. I don't think it's going to go all the way, but maybe you can take one and do a few more for next week. Mm-hmm. But it might interest you. I don't know why. The last page tells you how to score this, and you might be pleasantly surprised by some of the people in my class were, and if you're not, as a matter of fact, your anxiety is as high as you thought, well, then hopefully the class will help you.
We'll put this up on the smart site for maybe they don't get
a little. Oh, good idea. Yeah. Why didn't I get one?
Everyone follow their hands. And then it won't be like all of us. But that's good.
Look, there's a two.
That's good.
Okay,
thank you. And she's like, what are you doing? Well, I think you need a speech class to put it down.
Jeffrey wants to fit in, but.
Oh, he's okay. Coming in time?
Yeah.
Were you there for her sock thing?
Well, no, I missed it. Yeah. I
didn't
stop it.
Oh,
it's
okay.
I don't know. The pros and cons, because I knew if I wore my socks, the lady had wrecked because it was going quite well.
Yes.
Yep, at home.
You were signed up there or wherever it was.
But because I got a pretty big time. Went from there and yeah, and from the subject.
Oh, fail.
Oh, really? Yeah, something you said. I was thinking about writing at. I thought it was interesting, like, if the instructor has basically the items on the note card, and the speaker maybe hasn't even seen them. And the speaker is talking about with, my name's so and so, and I'm a substitute major, and the reason I'm in this program, whatever. And then the instructor pulls up, hobbies, or, pets, or something to show people that they don't have to have it written out. And the notes are just prompts to talk. And I was afraid, I didn't want to do the introductory speech the first night, the same reason we all probably don't, everybody hears it. But then I started thinking, well, shoot, if I have to do it later, they're going to memorize it, they're going to read it, so I'm going to find it spontaneous. But maybe if I force them to be spontaneous so that, support your best dad or support your worst dad or favorite movie or something like that.
I'm going to do my own reading class in middle school. I had little index cards with completely random stuff on it, like TV, dogs, anything. And I would give it to those people every minute.
Yeah, for an impromptu speech.
Yeah, but, and kind of. It makes you kind of think on your feet.
Prompting speech is, that's a high pressure situation. I would never make these people go through that.
Yeah,
but
I would possibly that. Yeah.
But if they're talking about themselves, and you know that they know the answer to, your mom's hometown or whatever, if they can think of anything to say about it, fine. My father's from Alabama. I've never been there. So, versus my mother's from Fresno, and I just hate Fresno. Love Fresno, whatever it might be. But my fear is that they're going to come in with a bunch of memorized speeches about themselves. And that's a different problem. The first speech they're doing for me is a narrative where they have to tell a story that of something that happened to them. I don't want to make sure it's a story you've told a whole bunch of people before. It can be a sad story, but something that happened to you or a family member. And so I think you're going to feel kind of silly if you memorize a story you've told. But I don't know how it's going to work. It works real well with the ordinary class.
I actually wanted to ask you. I wanted to step around because I'm never there when you.
Because I'm never there.
Every once in a while, someone would tell me, I know rather than you constantly. For some reason, she's always like,
Do
you? And she always tells me every conversation. I'm like, what can I do? I actually was meaning to ask you if it would be possible for me to audit your class. Maybe once,
but
this Monday one. Or
I don't. Well, it's coming
Monday.
But and the second one, the following Monday, is going to be almost exactly like this.
Okay.
A 2-hour version of this, where I'll remember the chart and some other things. The one after that is on content, and it'll be about an hour and 15 minutes on common content problems, and you're welcome to come.
I would love to. I just, I just want to kind of
Thank you.
Yeah,
okay,
that's
now here's
yeah.
Right,
you
do.
Go outside, close the door.